Matt Klein, owner of Red Wing Steelworks, and I've been getting a lot of emails lately with the trailer plans, with real simple questions. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to build a trailer, and we're going to do it step by step. I'm going to videotape everything. I'm going to build a 5x8 utility trailer, and you're going to see how easy this really is and how none of it is rocket science at all. It's based on common sense. So one of the first things I wanted to talk about was getting your axle at least ordered before you even start. And I like to get it in my hands, and that way I can measure my spring centers, and that'll determine the outside frame dimensions that you want to use. Now I've got an axle, it's a 3,500 pound axle with no brakes. So it's 58 inch spring centers. And what that means is that the outside dimensions of our trailer frame are gonna be 60 inches, 5 feet. So I wanted to make sure, I mean, if you build a frame first, you can always find an axle, you can always find someone to make you a custom axle. You know, if you're starting with a frame already, but since I wasn't, and I don't really want to screw around, I got the axle first. I mean, I knew I was going to build this, so that way we can make it perfect. So along with the axle kit, obviously it comes with the springs, your hubs, your bearings, everything. We'll talk about that when we get that far. You want to make sure you get your hanger bracket kit, U-bolts, everything I need to mount this to the trailer, I have. I don't need it first, but I have it first. I wanted it first so that I could build the right size frame. You never know. I mean, you can make this anything. I mean, this would work for a 6x10 trailer, a 4x8, a 4x6, whatever. It doesn't matter. This design is a good one. This is what you see out there. You can go to your corner store, and if it's a farm store or something, they probably sell these trailers. Menards, Lowe's. The thing about it is I like to build them, because the ones you find on the corner store or at Menards or Lowe's or wherever, they're light, they're cheap. A lot of times the welding sucks. When I do it myself, I know I'm gonna do a good job, and I'm making a heavy duty one myself for, I'm gonna mount a welder on it for my portable welding business. So I can have my tools, my torch, the welder itself, leads, extension cord, everything can all be on one trailer. I back it into my garage at night, unhook it, and I got a free pickup to use. I don't have a dedicated welding truck, no maintenance involved, things like that. So we're gonna do it step by step, and enjoy. All right, guys. We're starting out with raw steel, obviously. I got it all laid out here on sawhorses. And we got our channel iron. This is what we're gonna use for our hitch. It's 3 inch, 3.5 pound. I've got some 1/8 inch, 2x2 by 1/8 inch angle iron right here. That's gonna be like our top frame rail and so forth. And the structure for our trailer is gonna be this 2x2 by 3/16 right here. So I've got it all laid out. This video is going to be nothing flashy. Hollywood's not going to make this movie, so I am, and unfortunately we're kind of stuck in my garage, so we'll get going. I'm going to start cutting framework pieces, and we'll get to it when it's cut, and I'll show you how to set this stuff up. So anyway, there you go. Okay, now I've cut my trailer frame pieces. This is a side rail. This is the front of the trailer over here. Now, what I've done is I've taken and I've made this 45s. Cut 45 degree angles on there. And this front piece, th- This has a 45 on both ends. So what that's gonna do is make a nice corner. So now let's say you're gonna use plywood or something on here. It would end up just laying, this is right side up, it would end up just laying right in there, and you've got a nice little toe kick or whatever so things don't fall off. So that's gonna be the only 45s you need to do. All the rest of the pieces are gonna go underneath, and I'll show you here. And one thing I wanna say is take your time and make all the pieces exactly, cut them right, cut them to length, because it's really gonna help when we square this up. And you'll see squaring it up is important if you want this thing to trail right, so.
All right, guys, here's a picture of the corner where I 45'd it, and I've just got it obviously held in place with a vice grip. Now what I've got going here is, when I did, see that right there, that gap? Now when I did the 45, I did not cut this face. I only cut the long face at a 45. Now what that leaves me is a really nice corner weld. Look at the size weld I'll be able to put in there. Now that also adjusts the dimension just a hair, you know, the width of the iron, which is 3/16. So I'm gonna show you where that'll come in handy. So technically right now, this frame is measuring 60 3/8, because I got 3/16 extra on each side. And it's not a big deal for our hanger brackets, because I mean, what's 3/16 of an inch? Trust me, like I said, this is it's not rocket science at all. So all right, now where it comes in handy is back here. Now I've held this dimension from this point to the other side. I have 60 3/8, remember 3/16 on each side. So what I've got going here is, you can see that I'm not perfectly, you know, I'm set in just a hair that way. But when I flip this over and I'm welding, I'll be able to put a very nice bead in here. I don't know, I'll try and get you right here. I'll be able to lay a real nice bead. Whereas if this was flush, you can still lay a bead, but you're not, I don't know. It's just the little extras. I like to do it. If you have a problem with the dimensions changing, that 3/16 per side, you can always allow for it. You can always cut your pieces 3/16 short. So,
all right, now we're at the stage where we're gonna square this thing up. Now this is where it's gonna be real handy to cut your pieces right. Like, for instance, if this piece was a half inch longer than that one, you're never gonna get this square. It's not gonna happen. You could get this front square by using a square. You won't be able to do it like I'm gonna show you, unless the pieces are right. But you know, like, your back end is gonna be slanted. It's just, so take your time, measure twice, cut once. But now the theory behind this, if you don't know, is I have, this side is exactly the same as that side, and the front is exactly the same as the back for dimensions wise. So we have a rectangle. You square, rectangle, whatever, it doesn't matter, as long as you have two equal sides and then another two equal sides. What we can do is we can measure from corner to corner, and what we want is the same dimension. So I'm gonna pull a tape, I'm gonna pull it from this corner right here, and I'm gonna hook it. I wanna hook it the same when I do both sides, so it's good and hooked. And I'm getting my dimension here, and it looks like it's 114 1/2. And now I wanna do the exact same thing here. I wanna pull the tape from the corner, and I'm looking at my dimension here, 114 1/2. That's magic, right? Well, anyway, let's just say, we'll use easy figure. This is an example. Say I had 100 inches going this way and I had 99 inches going that way. What I would want to do is I would want to squeeze these two corners together. And what that does, by squeezing them together, it pushes those out. And we're going to split the difference. So if I was an inch off, I would want to get 99 and a half. And then that side should be 99 and a half also. So that's why we're just clamped right now. So I've got it perfect. What I'm going to do is tack. And I'll show you how I'm going to tack this. I'm just going to tack the four outside corners. And that's our next step. Okay, I've flipped this over. Everything's tacked. It's square. I've double checked. I've got it tacked on the outside corner, the inside corner. Same with the back side. And I want to flip it upside down because now we're at the point where we're going to be putting on our cross members. They're going to be just like this, where they go right on top. But before we get there, it's time to start worrying about our axle. So a good rule of thumb, generically speaking, is the trailer frame. This is the trailer frame. We're not counting hitch or anything. You want 60% of the trailer frame to be in front of the axle, or 40% to be behind the axle. So we've got 96 inches. 60% of that is 57.6. I'm going 58. So what I'm doing is I'm pulling my tape from the exact outside front and I'm putting a mark at 58. That's going to be my center of axle. That's what I'm going to use. That'll be good. If you have the axle more in the center, if you don't have enough tongue weight, this thing is going to be all over the road. It's going to fishtail on you. So I've always been of the opinion that you're better off having some weight on your truck, you know, have more tongue weight than you are not. And how my application that I'm going to use is I'm basically going to center my big welder. It's a 1,500 pound industrial Miller welder. I'm going to be centering that right over the axle. And then I'll be able to have room for tools and torches up front, plus the hitch weight. I'll have plenty of tongue weight. You don't want too much, otherwise it's all on your suspension, but I'll have plenty. So in this application for a 5x8 trailer, I'm going 58 inches to center of axle. And I'm going to put the axle together, and then we're going to start worrying about hanger brackets. All right, I'm going to start putting the axle together. I'm at the point now where I am going to install the wheel bearings and the seal. We're going to put it on. I just want to show you a couple things. You'll see that this is not an exact circle here. You've got a flat spot, and I've got a flat spot on my spindle. So this is the washer, and then obviously your castle nut, and that's what's going to hold the hub on. So let's get to it here. And there's no good way to, I haven't figured out a way to do this without getting grease everywhere. So get yourself some rags, get them handy. All right, now I have two different sizes here. Now I already packed these, but I'll show you how to pack them. I've got the larger one, and it's self-explanatory. For the back side of the hub that goes against the spindle face is going to be the larger one, and then the smaller one is going to be here. So pretty much what you want to do to pack them is get yourself a handful of grease, and you basically just want to work it. You just want to just keep packing grease in until it's coming out of every little orifice or hole. There's just no other, I don't know, there's bearing packers and stuff, but doing it by hand, I've used them. I actually used them on this, and I think I ended up doing most of it by hand anyway. Just make sure it's good and greased stuff, because you don't want to be replacing these. So what we're going to do, there's no way around this for me to get grease all over the place. is I'm going to install this, and the tapered side goes down. You can see it's pretty self-explanatory when you do it. So I'm going to install that. Now I'm going to try and get rid of some of this grease. Bear with me. I know if you know what you're doing, you're going to want to fast forward this part. I don't want to leave anybody out. So, and this is fairly important to make sure you get enough grease on everything. That way, you don't have to replace wheel bearings ever. These things should last almost forever. Okay, I've got the bearing installed. I'm gonna get a little bit of grease off of this lip here. And basically the seal is just a little rubber. And I'm gonna put that in so that the flat side is out. And we're gonna install that. I'm gonna have to cut for a second while I get it. Okay, I'm back. Now, we're just gonna wanna slightly tap all the way around. We're basically gonna flush that up. Get it so it's nice and flush on top. And we're gonna, actually, before I do that, I wanna put some more grease in. I want to grease this up, the spindle, real good. There's just no way around it, guys. And I want to make sure to get some inside here. Grease everywhere. The more grease, the better, trust me. So now, one-handed, I'm going to try and install this. Okay, and that just seats, it just goes right up until it can't push it on any farther. And that seal keeps the dirt and stuff out of the backside. So, I'm going to want to pack my small bearing, which I'm doing. Grease, grease, grease. Looks like I've got plenty. And now that one's going to be installed. And you'll see that's what holds that on. Push that on the rest of the way. We got our wheel bearing going here. We want to make sure that gets in nice. Keep that grease. We're greased up pretty well. Now my castle nut. Now what you want to do with this is I'm going to use this wrench and we're going to tighten this up, but we don't, I'll show you what I'm doing here. I'm just going to keep going until she starts getting tight. Now this, you can see that that's just a hair too tight. So now I'm going to want to back this off just until that hole, for our cotter pin. There's the hole right there. Okay. Flatten that out. There's our hole. Double check that. Back it off one more hole, it feels kind of tight. And we don't want this it's all loose coming apart either. Say we're feeling real good. Next step here is I'm gonna bend my cotter pin. There. Now, dust cap. You want that dust cap on. And that's just gonna tap on with an end. Get it so she's all flush. Get whatever grease you have on here on. And there we go. Okay, now we've got both hubs on. Everything's greased up. We're good to go. Shouldn't have to mess with that anymore. Now, time to put the springs on. This is real easy. I'm just going to show you real quick. Now, I've got this axle upside down. Now, I don't know how well you can see this, but you can see that it's got a bend in the middle. When we're going to mount that on the trailer and the trailer is sitting the way it should, this bend needs to be up. Okay? So, right now, the axle is upside down. Alright? Since it's upside down, I'm going to put the springs on upside down. Now this axle is actually going to be here, and this is right side up. So, and see this little peg right here? They have a hole for that right on the spring seat. So we're going to find that home there. We've got our U-bolt plate keeper. That's got a center hole. That goes right over the top of this peg. Flip it upside down. You want these little things to be up. Our U-bolt slips right over the axle and right into the first two holes. I've got lock nuts with the kit. It's just sitting on here. This stuff is sort of tight. It's not really tight. I can still knock it around, but it's basically together. So our next step, okay, I have my 58 inch that I wanted to hold for dead center of the axle. Now I've gone ahead and I've double checked that. I mean, it's close enough. Again, none of this stuff is that critical. I like to get everything square. Now, this is another thing I like to do. Measure from my front, and I'll measure dead center to my bolt hole, and do the same thing on the other side and make sure they're right on, and put some marks down. My next step, now that I'll put these on, these are just regular, they came with the trailer kit. They're 9/16 bolts that go through these shackles. This is the front of the hanger bracket. This is the one that's going to be solid in place and does not move. The back one we'll show you in a bit. That's going to, you know, this is going to be up a little bit and it's got shackles. So when you hit a bump and the spring collapses, that, you know, you got your travel. But the front one stays put. So this is the one you measure off. So as long as you have this the same, that the same, and I have everything centered up on this on the side rail, you should be good to go. I'm going to go ahead and tack these down now. Okay, I've tacked this, the front ones, they're in place. I've tacked them in four corners, so, and I've double, triple checked all the measurements. It's perfect, it's good. So, that's not going anywhere. now what I've done is I've put my shackle brackets on. Everything's just loose. Just slid the bolt through, put the nut on. Now the key to these, now this trailer manufacturer recommends, I'll show a close up in a little bit, but they recommend putting this down the horseshoe shape like this. And I can see why, you get a lot more welding surface and so forth. So what you want to do is center that up. Now you want the spring bolt to be just a hair back from the mount bolt. So what that's going to do, now this is upside down, but when you get weight on there, when you hit bumps, it's going to allow this to go down, and then that's going to move backward. So that's where you get your travel. That's how come you're not breaking springs every time. So what I'm going to do is, generally, I don't know exactly what the rule of thumb, I've read anything from 10 degrees, but I don't know if that's with sitting upright with weight on it or not. What I've always done is just, since there's no weight on here right now except for axle weight, I just go just slightly past center. And that way when I flip it over and we start putting everything else on, you know, this will gradually work its way more. Just so it's not centered or in front of center. If it was too far this way, your spring wouldn't travel and you'd have a mess. So I'm gonna go ahead and tack these down and then I'll take some close-up shots.
Again, guys, this is just for reference. There's the front bracket. There's our mechanism, or our U-bolts. And then here's the shackle brackets. Now you can see how they're just past center toward the rear of the trailer. Now that'll change quite a bit when we put weight on it. And from here, I'll be able to get some good welds inside and around. And the same with this. These are important welds, guys. If you're not up to the task, find someone that is. This holds the wheels underneath your trailer.
Okay, now we're at the point where we're gonna add the rest of the cross members. Now, what I do, this is the difference between buying those cheap ones at Menards or Lowe's, is I like to go 16 inch on center, wherever possible. The cheap ones, not only are you getting thinner material, you're lucky that you'll, well, I shouldn't say lucky, but I think they go 24 inch centers. So basically you got two less cross members in the trailer. Well, I know that I have the potential to really, abuse this. So I like to beef it up whenever possible. Now this one is going to be critical because this is going to be part of your hitch. So you definitely want to make sure you have the same measurement, you know, so everything in this section is square. The rest of these aren't a real big deal. So I got 16 inch center, 16 inch center. Now the axle screws me up, so I can't do 16 inch center necessarily. You know, that would land about here. So what I did was I just stayed a couple inches away from the axle itself, and I put these in. Now I orientated them this way so that, you know, if I had this over here, this could potentially hit before the axle would hit. But right now the axle is going to hit the bottom of the frame before anything is going to touch either one of these two cross members. So there's no science to it. I just made sure that I wanted more than just one, because I'm going to be putting a really heavy welder across the axle, so I beefed it up. You could get away with just putting one if you're just going to be hauling yard waste or, you know, whatever, if it's not that heavy duty. I'm just telling you what I'm doing. So anyhow, we have no trouble there with the clearance, and then I went 16 inches from the back. That's what it ends up being. So you've got 7 cross members total, counting the front and the back. So next step, I'm just going to tack this all in. Everything should already be square. Nothing's going to change now unless we start cutting things apart. So I'm going to tack these up And our next step is going to be we're going to work on the hitch and get that going.
All right, guys. Here's the hitch. And I'm just using a standard, what do they call an A-frame hitch? It's a 50 degree. This is standard completely. You'll find it in any store that sells this kind of stuff. But what I'm using for the hitch itself, you know, this is just laid up here. I'm using it like sawhorses. And I'm using 3-inch channel, 3.5 pound per foot. That's how they classify that stuff. Now, I just wanted to show you how I set it up. I'll give you the dimensions. Well, I can give them to you now, but both of these two pieces are 62 inches long. And what that's going to get us, and you'll see when we go to set that up, is I'm going to be able to stay 4 feet in from edge of hitch to front of trailer frame. That sounds a little confusing, I know, but I just wanted to show you before I tack this up. I have it clamped both flat on the bottom and flat on the sides. And I'm going to want to put a few bit good tacks on there and just to keep that so I don't have to screw around trying to keep that in place. This will all be one big A-frame unit. Then all I have to do, oh, I'll show you this too. I didn't cut any angles. I didn't know what it would be right now. So what I did was I took a straight edge across and you know, basically just butted it up to both sides here. And then I drew my line. That is going to be butted right up into here. So I can get nice and flat and everything should get welded together nice and smooth. So I just wanted to show you that. Make sure you got everything nice and tight. Centered, I mean, as far as the same amount from here sticking out on both sides, that way everything's nice and square. I'm gonna go ahead and tack this up and then we'll put this on the trailer.
Okay, now this is all tacked up. Like I said, I double checked all the dimensions, everything's good. I cut my straight line here, so this would get butted up along this rail. It's going to get welded, obviously, to here. It's going to get welded to here. And then when I put my floor in, now, those two alone ought to be enough. I happen to be using a steel floor, so I'm also going to weld to there. If you were using wood, it's no big deal. This is plenty, like I said, because you're not having... You don't want all your weight on the tongue. Really, you should be able to, you know, it might be heavy, but you should be able to almost lift the tongue up by yourself. Unless, you know, a car trailer is different. That's got two axles and it doesn't pivot like that. But I have this centered. Basically, I took this dimension, whatever that came out to be, and I took the outside frame dimension, and I subtracted and divided by 2, gave me 3 1/4 from each end of the frame in, so I have that perfectly that way. Now, a good way to check this is to pick a point on your axle. I don't know if you can see this or not, I'm going to pick this axle plate point. You'll see it when I come over to the other side. But I'm going to pull my tape there, and I'm going right to dead center of this mechanism bolt here. It's a good reference. So I have 9 foot 3/8 of an inch. Now I'm going to pull my tape from the same point. I know it's hard to see on this video, but trust me, there's a square plate there that I can use that's close enough. And I've got 9 foot 5/16. So I'm off by 1/16 of an inch. Big deal. It's not going to matter. This thing's going to trailer like a dream. So everything's square. That's the whole point. If you have everything square to start with, everything just, it makes it so much smoother on down the line. If you didn't have this square, I'd run into all kinds of problems and we'd have to adjust. make one of these legs longer than the other, and it's kind of a pain. You can also cross-reference, you know, I measured from corner of frame, I did all that, triple checked everything, it all looks good. So basically, we're gonna do some welding. This is critical welding too, by the way. Obviously, also, don't forget, when you mount this, make sure this is upside down when your trailer's upside down. It's real easy to forget about little things like that, and then you go to flip the trailer over and your hitch is upside down, you gotta cut everything apart. As far as the hitch goes, I made it for a 2-inch ball, so I'm basically gonna tack this all up, and now I'm at the point where I'm ready to weld everything while this thing is upside down. So I'm gonna weld everything up. Now I wanna skip around. Like, I'll weld a little bit here, then I'll start welding over there. Jump around, that way you're not just pouring heat all into, you know, one spot. By the time I get back over to this area, this will cool down a little bit. So that's what you wanna do when you're welding, and that way things aren't twisting and warping. It's gonna move a little bit, but that's no big deal. If you feel like you need more welding surface, you could put gussets in here. You know, cut yourself some plate. I'm not gonna do that because, like I said, I'm gonna have sheet metal on here, and I'm just gonna stitch it to the sheet metal so it'll be welded to the floor and the framework. But you know, suit yourself. If you're using wood, might not be a bad idea to put a little extra something in, just for more welding surface. You don't need any more beef on the trailer. The only reason for the gussets would be to get more weld from the hitch to the trailer. So, yeah, I'm gonna weld it up and then we're gonna flip this thing over. Okay, now I got everything welded underneath that I wanted to, and I'll explain a little bit about that in a second here. So obviously flipped it upside down, got it upright. And our next step is going to be welding our framework on for our sides. Now back to the welding. I kept an eye on it when I was welding all this stuff underneath, when it was flipped upside down. And I noticed that it was starting to bow a little bit. Actually, it was going this way because it was the other way around. So I didn't want to put any more heat. I ended up only welding the outsides of all these. I just put one bead. Now, I'll back up a little bit. I stick welded it instead of wire feeding, which I don't know why. I just did because I have plenty of rods and I thought I'd use them up. So it probably got a little hotter than I wanted to, which is good because now it gives me a chance to explain how to remedy the situation. I'm gonna go back and weld this stuff, but first I'm gonna put our framework on, get everything tacked up, and what that's gonna do is it's gonna act like a bridge. It'll stiffen everything up so you don't get so much of this. So when I start putting heat to all these, it weakens the metal and then it cools down, it contracts, and eventually this thing could look like a banana if you don't take care of it. So I noticed that was gonna happen, so I slowed down, decided I'll just weld it enough to flip it over, and we'll put the side racks on, and it'll act like a good bridge. That'll solve that problem. So I'm kinda glad it happened because you know, I'd hate for you to be welding everything up and have it look like a banana when you're done. So if I would have used a wire feed, it maybe wouldn't have put quite as much heat. You know, a stick welder burns a little hotter. I was using 70-18s, so, and I had her cranked up pretty good. The hitch and everything came out fine. Nothing moved there. I got all that welded up. But so anyway, we're ready now. I'm gonna tack our sides on. I've got fenders to put on, and we'll go from there. Okay, so I've tacked up this first side. I just wanted to say a little something. I didn't take a whole lot of time and fumble around with a square. I mean, you can do that, but what I did was I put a speed square on, just like this, put it on there, drew a line, put my piece of angle iron right up to the line. It came out really good. It came out perfect. Just follow your lines. And what I did was I stayed back just a hair right here so I could get a good weld there. And then now I stayed back, like say, for instance, it doesn't matter what you do, but I stayed back 3/8 of an inch. So I had my top rail stick past 3/8 of an inch, because what I'm going to want here is the one coming across is just going to meet up with this, and you'll see when we get that far. I put them on wherever there was a cross member. So basically these are 16 inch center also. Not necessary. I mean, you don't have to do that. You can do whatever you want, really, because it just depends on how, like if you're going to strap things down by having your ratchet straps on, you know, hooking on here, you might want to put a few more on. But I wanted, you got to make sure and leave room for your fenders. So I just wanted to tack everything up, and I'll grab a fender. These are fenders that I just bought at a local store. I mean, price tag's still on there, $31.99. Like I say in my plans, you just can't build fenders that look worth a darn compared to what you can buy them for. But how these are gonna go, and I might do this last, but basically I'm just gonna center them up this way, center them up this way. It's gonna sit in here. I'm gonna weld here. I'm gonna weld here, here. They already have a back on them, which for me wasn't really necessary because I might put side steel on, but I don't know. It actually works out perfect if you were going to leave it in an open trailer. It's nice to have the back on the fender. And then you don't get any road spray, you know, I'm in the snowy area. So I won't get all that stuff in the trailer or on anything that I'm hauling. So it'll be nice. Basically, I just wanted to give you an idea here. If you're going to build your own fenders, now would be the time. You might want to piece them together to make sure that these aren't in your way before you weld everything up. And one more thing. Back here, I know it's a little hard, but it's hard to see, but we'll get a better view when I start doing the ramp. I left this 2 inches longer. So like this bottom frame rail piece is 96 inches, 8 foot. This is 98. And I left the 2 inches stick out the back. And basically what that's gonna be is room for a pin to latch our ramp so that the ramp stays up. A real quick issue that came up, this stuff happens. On paper, everything works perfect, but when you get out and start doing stuff, not everything works perfect. I think when I welded underneath, the angle iron might have rolled a little bit. Either way, I had a little bit, both of these sides were spread out a little bit. So what I did, this is a real simple fix. I just grabbed a ratchet strap, pulled it together, got the measurement that I want, and now my front piece is gonna fit exactly perfect. Now, it wouldn't matter if it's out a little bit, but if you had already cut this, it would be nice to get it to fit, you know, if you cut it beforehand. So I just wanted to mention, I try and get these tips as they come up, you know, things happen. It happens to everybody, so it's a real simple fix if you have a ratchet strap or anything, come along, whatever. You can just pull it together. Once I get it tacked in, everything's going to be nice and square. Okay, we got our front on, everything, all this railing is tacked in place. I just wanted to show an example of, you saw earlier when I was jiggling this thing around, and now, I mean, you can see how stiff it is just by adding this stuff. I mean, I'll point out too, just like on the plans, this is 2x2x8. This is 2x2x8. you know, to keep the weight down, keep the cost down. I don't feel that this needs to be that heavy duty, but you can see how stiff eighth inch actually makes this. I think it's great. I mean, now if you start welding, I'd still skip around. Believe me, you can still get this thing to look like a banana if you just start pouring heat in one spot and then, you know, move on to the next. So I'd weld that one and then go over here and then there and then here. And, you know, by the time you get back over here, that's cooled down. And, you know, I'd still skip around. So I just want to give you an example. I mean, look at this here. Watch the trailer. You know, before this was on, you know, that was flexing a little bit. So even if you just wanted a flatbed, if that's what you wanted, I mean, truthfully, that's all I really need, but this bridging really helps. I mean, this is like gives your trailer strength. So it's looking heavier duty as we go. So just an idea. And you know, once we get the fenders in, they don't look like much. It's gonna help. You know, everything helps. So my next step, I'm thinking I might mount the fenders. And then we can mess with the ramp tailgate in a little bit.
All right, I just wanted to show quickly how I did this fender to get it centered and perfect and everything. Obviously took the tire off so you can get to the framework. And basically what I did was I measured, you know, I measured and made sure that the back of my axle, I put a center mark on the framework, and then I put a center mark on the trailer. I lined up those two marks. That way I'm dead center on that tire, and it's not gonna look ridiculous. And I put it tight up to here. I put a tack on there, and I'll probably just, you know, I'll weld across it. It's not gonna take much. These fenders aren't meant to be, you know, climbed on, so to speak, but. And then, you know, tack it right there. I'll weld here. And obviously I'm going to weld back here. And then underneath here, I'll probably put a few stitches, you know, just so it's not banging and rattling. And that should be good. I just wanted to show you that. My next step now, before I go ahead and weld this up, is I'm going to double check because I'm going to throw that tire back on. And everything should work fine. I hope so. It's too late to take this fender back. But I already did my double checking, so we should be good. And some guys, I don't know, I've seen it before where they add a piece of angle iron out here or put something along the bottom edge, but I'm not gonna do that in this case. If I dent up the fender, I dent up the fender. I mean, they're cheap enough for me to replace it if I have to, so I just wanted to show you that. Okay, I just put the tire on just to make sure. Now there's one more thing I want to bring up about this, and it might not be a bad idea to get your fenders, and I did this, but double check before you put these side racks on. You know, you might want to make that side rack a hair bigger if you feel you need more clearance. Right now I measured this, I have 2.5 inches before that tire bottoms out, which happens to be the exact same distance I have before my axle bottoms out against the frame. Like I said, this is a 3,500 pound axle, we shouldn't be bottoming out, but if you overload it, or going down some pretty bumpy roads, it's possible, but I'm not gonna wreck anything. So just something to consider before you put your side racks on, because now would be a bad time to find out, oh man, I should have had my fender up another inch. Well, I forgot to mention, but I kind of pre-arranged, you know, pre-measured all that stuff before I even did this. So just something to keep in mind.
I get a lot of questions from email about the hinge and the ramp setup, so I wanted to take a little time and talk about you know, how this works, and so everyone's got a really good idea. This is 3/4 black pipe, schedule 40. Any welding shop should have this. This is supposed to be 3/4 inch hot roll rod, but I just realized I don't have any. I thought I did, but I didn't. So it's kind of embarrassing, but I found some 3/4 threaded rod. It works just the same. I mean, you can go to any hardware store and get this. But what I wanted to talk about was the hinge itself. Now, I cut these, and then you're going to want to deburr the edges of these so, you know, it's not sharp and it's smooth, because when you have this together, it, you don't want any binding, really. I mean, it'll wear off, but still, I like to start nice. And basically, the big one, the 4-inch one, goes in the middle. I have two 2-inch ones that go on the ends. And now you're going to want to leave just a little clearance, you know, between here and there. That way nothing ever binds up. You get dirt and crud in there. It's always going to work smooth. Now how I'm going to do this is I'm going to end up welding this, and I'm going to weld this. So the two 2-inch pieces along with the 3/4 rod are all going to be one unit. And the only the center one's going to spin. And what I do then is, I'll show you more, but basically I'm going to put this, I've got it marked out. You can do whatever you want. If you have a specific lawnmower or something, maybe wherever the tires are going to ride, maybe that's where you want to put your hinge, because that's where it's going to be strong. I just chose 8 inches, and I got 8 inches worth of hinge here, 8 inches over there. And the ones that are going to stay put, I'm going to weld them to the framework. And like I said, then only the tailgate and the center one is going to spin. That's how I'm going to do it. Now, I've had plans in the past where I've basically done this with 4, 4, and 4. And I've run the rod all the way across, you know, so you have like a 5-foot long piece of 3/4 inch rod. Well, money is money, and everything is getting more expensive these days. And you're not hauling a skid steer on a trailer like this. So, yeah, I just look at it. You know, I have a tendency to overkill everything, but I'm getting better. So I really toned down the hinges, and believe me, this is still plenty strong enough. I mean, someone would look at this and say 3/4, are you kidding? You know, but whatever, it's not much. I mean, this versus a 1/2-inch setup, what are you talking, a couple bucks? So anyway, and the bigger, it's like the bigger the tire, the easier it is to roll over stuff. The bigger the diameter, the bigger the rod, the less likely stuff's gonna bind and rust up, and then pretty soon your ramp doesn't work. But I mean, there's a ton of ways to do this. I've seen trailers where they just come off here with a flat iron with a hole in it, and then your tailgate also has a hole in it, and that's your hinge. More power to you. I mean, that would work. I just choose to go this way. It's stronger this way. This will help the you'll see, but when we put the ramp on, the angle iron that I use for the ramp, this hinge alone is going to beef that up, so that's not going to bend on you. So anyway, I'm going to tack this up. I'm going to get it tacked onto here. You'll see, and then we'll go to install our ramp, and you'll see how that works and how we latch it here. So we'll get to it. I wanted to talk just a second, now that I have this the hinges tacked on, I wanted to talk about welding, to make sure that you get it welded on the top and the bottom of the hinge. That way it's not going to be able to peel off or anything. And try not to get anything on the other one that, you know, you don't want to accidentally weld this one down. You know, this one's only going to get welded to your ramp piece. Now, these hinges work great if, you know, if you're putting plywood or if you're putting flat steel like I'm doing, this is the way to go, in my opinion. But there is a possibility that you're going to want to use 2x4s. Now, if you want to use 2x4s on both the ramp and the tailgate and the floor, you're going to need to probably do what I talked about. Some trailer manufacturers do, where they put this piece of flat iron out with a hole in it, and you're going to need this hinge a little bit further out. That way, when you fold it up, your 2x4 has some clearance here. I know it's kind of hard to, I can't cover every single, I'm trying to point out the problem, I guess. It just depends on what you're going to use for a floor. So basically, if you're using expanded metal or something, you're fine. If you're using 2x4s on your ramp, I feel like, well, that could get kind of heavy, but you know, if you want to do that, you're going to have to adjust your hinges. You're probably not going to be able to use a style like this because you're going to run into clearance problems. When you close it up, that 2x4 is going to want to hit that 2x4. Either that, or you put another cross member in, here, and end your 2x4s there, then you wouldn't have a problem. So it's just the little things like that you kind of want to plan ahead with. But like I said, for flat and flat, it's good. Okay, now I've got a little bit of a confession to make. I'm not building a ramp per se, but this is basically exactly the same as how I would build the ramp, and I have done it in the past, except for I made this a foot tall. I would make my ramp 4 or 5 feet, but it would be the same thing. I took the time and I 45 degreed the corners just like we did for the trailer frame, and I squared it up the same way, corner to corner. Now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put a couple of these in just like this, like we did for all the other sides. Now, you could do this for your ramp, or you could do something like put it in so it's flat like that, so you get a good weld. If you're going to use expanded metal or something, you'll be able to weld it to here. And this is another one of those things where it's common sense. If you're putting a big, heavy lawnmower or riding lawnmower on here, I would put at least 2 where you're going to have the tires or where you're going to have the most of the weight on here. But like I said, you know, from what I'm doing, I'm setting up a portable welding trailer. I'm just going to go like this because the only thing I'm going to use this for is probably just a little table. If I have to haul something a little bit longer. Truthfully, this thing's going to be up most of the time, just like a normal side rack, but I wanted to do it like I'd do a ramp. Like I said, the only thing different is the length. But as you can see, obviously it's tacked only to the ones that move. You know, these are stationary. I got it tacked on both sides. We're gonna get it welded up. But like I said, on my plans, I might change them, I don't know, but generally the manufacturers, I've seen them from 5 foot long to 4 foot long, generally speaking, and you know, it gives you about an angle like that to drive something up. If you've got something that really sits low, you can't raise your deck up very high on your mower, you'll want a longer ramp to lessen this angle. If it's no big deal, if you're putting a ATV on or something, you got plenty of clearance, you can go with a shorter ramp because, you know, the transition in angles isn't going to matter. So basically, the next step I'm going to do here is I'm going to drill holes through here and make my keepers, and I'll tack my pieces in. I left these out so I could show you, you know, if I was doing something for a ramp, I would put multiple pieces in, but since I'm not, I'm just going to do it like I did the sides. So we'll build our keepers. I would say we're really starting to wind this thing down. We'll look at taillight brackets. You know, that's variable too. There's a million different taillights out there you can use. And I'm going to mount my jack, put my floor in. I don't know what I'm going to do with the sides yet, if I'm going to put steel on. I have steel for them, but we're starting to wind down and starting to look like something. And I try to cover as much as I can, but, you know, there's always, someone's always going to build something a little different and need it for a different purpose, and I just, you know, I'm trying to cover as many bases as I can here. So, anyway, we'll get started on probably doing our little taillight brackets right now.
All right, here's the taillight bracket. You can see there's nothing to it at all. It's just a piece of 2x2x8 angle, 8 inches long, and basically from this point to this point, I picked 12 inches. I have no idea why. It seemed like a good spot for it. So just drilled two holes. Again, you got 50 different kinds of taillights a person can use. I just happen to have these in my drawer. I've had them for about 10 years, and I'm gonna use them. What the heck? Now, some people will go ahead and they'll, you know, completely enclose it, except, you know, for the back. They'll enclose it so that they don't get wrecked, and that's a good idea, but I'm not going to do that. These are too cheap, too easy to replace, so I'm just going to go with this. Now, I mentioned that I was going to mount the jack, and I had no idea that I got something that bolted together. I didn't even look. I just wanted something with a wheel, so I guess that wasn't too difficult to do. I can slide it around wherever I want. So, you know, I wanted to mention one good thing about this style of an A-frame hitch is that it's pre-made for one of the jacks that go straight down into that hole, and it's the bolt pattern's correct to accept one of those. So I could always put one of those on. They're a little bit more expensive, but they're also a lot better. But I like these that flip up because I just have to drop it onto the ball hitch and, you know, raise it up just a little bit, and then I can go ahead and flip it up. I've had this style where it just seems like you're cranking forever, and when it's cold, 20 below zero, and you're doing it. I mean, it's not a big deal, but it's a pain. So, we're pretty much winding down here. Now, I have everything made as far as framework goes, and I've got a lot of welding to do. So I'm gonna weld the sides, get all that stuff welded, and then I'm gonna drop my floor in, and that is self-explanatory. I mean, you cut it to fit, and I can talk about when it's in, you know, how much I'd stitch weld it. It's certainly not going to be welded solid, but I'll put a bunch of little stitches all over the place, because the more stitch welding you do, the less banging and clanging you hear behind you. So hopefully we'll be done here shortly. And then comes the worst part for me anyway, which is paint. I'm not looking forward to painting, but I guess it goes with everything. So, okay guys, I just put the steel in the floor and I got it all welded down. And I was just gonna give you an idea of how much welding I put down. And you can see I just stitched it I did about, you know, 2 inches every foot. And that is plenty. I mean, we're not talking about anything really for strength here. It's just, but it ties everything together. And here's one thing I wanted to show you. You can see right from the top, you see those little stitch marks right there and there? That's my hitch that I welded from underneath. And you can see that I got good penetration because it really marked up the steel from the top side. And that is something to look for. If you're doing welding and you're welding on sheet metal especially and you don't see that, that means your welds aren't very good. you definitely should be able to see that. Now you can see it in different areas around here where I've, you know, welded it on. This is a cross member here, and you know, you can see them. You should be able to see that kind of stuff, because that tells you you're getting good penetration. I use 10 gauge sheet metal on here, but that is plenty heavy duty for this kind of a trailer. The only reason I used it instead of 12 gauge or even maybe 14 gauge is because I got a heck of a deal on it, and it was actually cheaper to buy this from a friend of mine than it would be to order new stuff, so I used it. Anyhow, obviously we'll go over some more stuff. I mean, a lot of guys are going to put wood, plywood, you know, expanded metal, things like that. So, okay, here's another view of underneath the trailer, just to give an idea of the cross members. Now, I went ahead, you know, I put a stitch there, I put a stitch here. And then on the back side, I put a couple of them in the middle. I know it might be kind of hard to see, but basically I have 4 stitches about 3 inches long on each cross member. So I guess, you know, the more the merrier. Like I say, I like to overbuild stuff. But I'd say that's probably... That would be about a minimum that you'd want to do if you're putting sheet metal on, because it ties everything together nicely. The trailer's stronger because of it. It's just and it also, it'll be a lot less rattling going down the road. You won't have metal slapping against metal. That can be annoying. So it's worth the time. If you're doing it, do it before you paint it. Well, the worst part, in my opinion, is over with, the painting. I actually started getting ready to mount my welder in and everything before I realized I forgot to shoot a video of the finished product. So, here we go. There's mounted the safety chains. Again, I don't know what's all legal for every state. I know in Minnesota, the DMV likes you gotta have those safety chains that you can hook up to your vehicle, and I can't possibly know what states have what laws, and I just don't even want to venture to guess. The only thing I can say is check with the DMV or Google it or something and find out. And we definitely want to be legal. I'm not advocating not being legal, but and some trailers also require a side marker light that would be mounted up front here in the front corners. To be honest, I don't even know if that's has to be done in Minnesota or not, but I can always put those on and add it into the wiring that I've already done. So yeah, I guess we're wrapping this thing up. I hope you guys enjoyed the video, and I hope you got something out of it. You can always You can always get a hold of me by email if you have any other questions, or visit my website. I plan on keep updating it as we make changes or as we decide to do more designs or what have you. So I guess we're done for this trailer. Thank you for watching.